Welcome back to Playing the Gray. This is Dave Briglio, and this is a podcast where we take a topic that you probably will agree with, but to what degree and for what reasons, it's not always black and white. It's in the middle where we have discussions, and in these I have multiple guests, and the topics are from Lance Loya. We're going to be doing a few of these here in the coming weeks, but Lance Loya is coach, speaker, inspiring person who's main tagline is be a good teammate, and we'll get into that in a little bit. Also with us is Jim Bauman, experienced sports psychologist at the collegiate, professional, Olympic level, also former guest of mine, as Lance was on Making the Play. Great perspective on, when we get into some of these topics, what is often the athlete thinking. And rounding out is Mike Salm. He also was on a show previously with, he's from Rutgers, and with the leadership development and strategic partnerships at Rutgers. And again, when you hear these topics, you'll kind of understand why they do come back to inspiring leadership. So welcome everybody. And Lance, I'm going to let you explain our first topic here, which is good teammates don't confuse compliance for commitment. And what was the inspiration for that?
Yeah, Dave, great to be back. As always, a pleasure to talk to you. Man, I am humbled to be with your other two panelists tonight. So let me give you a little of the context behind that particular tweet, as it was. Good teammates don't confuse compliance for commitment. At the time when I put that out there, and I still do, the premise for being a good teammate were the three core standards of care, share, and listen. Now, every positive attribute of a good teammate falls into one of those categories, care, share, listen. To me, listening meant following orders, following the coach's instructions, being compliant. And, I thought that being compliant demonstrated a commitment to the team. And I operated off that assumption for quite some time. And then there was a string of stories in the news that made me think otherwise. Maybe I was wrong on that assumption. There was a story about a high school wrestling team and an unfortunate hazing incident. And the older players told some of the younger players what they should be doing. And then there was a story in the news about an employee, an administrator was caught embezzling. And her defense was, well, my bosses told me to do this. And then, one of the other stories, there was a soccer team, and the coach had instructed one of the players to take out an opposing team's player. And I thought about it. I thought they were all following their leader's instructions, and they were complying with those, but they weren't good teammates. No, that's not what being a good teammate is about. And, and I started thinking about, well, compliance isn't what makes them a good teammate. It's their commitment to doing what is best for the team. And following your leader's instructions is not necessarily what's best for your team. So compliance might not necessarily make you a good teammate. So understanding the difference between compliance and commitment is really what makes you a good teammate.
And that is really tough, especially at, the high school or new to the collegiate level, where there is, there's a brotherhood, a sisterhood, that we're together, we're one. And, that's what a team is. We're here through thick and thin for each other. And it can get confusing as to when I'm supposed to have your back and when is it unreasonable that I demand you have your back? And I think there is, like I say, a lot of pressure. You mentioned all those situations, from athletes to the real world. And I'd like to bring Jim into this now, because this really comes into, that anxiety over, did I just let my team down by not doing something that part of me says I shouldn't do? Or maybe even, okay, I'm doing whatever you want, it can all be good things, but I'm just assuming that that's what a display of commitment is. Anything you want to add to that? I guess, you know, with your experience working with so many different teams and players at different levels, Jim.
Yeah, sure, Dave. a couple of things. One is this past weekend, I just got back from attending a basic underwater demolition school SEAL qualification team graduation. So this is where a group of young people start training, you know, over a year ago, actually. And for those people who are left and still standing, they graduate and get their trident, you know, on that day. So Friday was a graduation that I went down to San Diego and attended. And as we've talked before, you know, I've talked about working with, you know, special operations and, you know, SEALs and stuff like that. And they are totally the epitome of this commitment, you know, kind of to each other, you know, that Lance is talking about. And I think sometimes we think that that sort of is born into people, you know, and maybe there is a genetic component to that, like there is everything else, you know, in terms of being part of something, and that's an important thing for you, and that's an easy thing for you to kind of bring along. And there's some environmental things as well, you know, that go along with that as, you know, as well. So with this particular group of people, I mean, they're the most committed group of people I've ever seen. I've never seen a team or team glue or cohesion, anything like you do with these special operator, you know, kinds of teams. So that's one extreme, but I think it's good to have a picture of the extreme and then back it off to where we are with younger athletes, you know, and that sort of thing as well. The other thing that kind of plays into this a little bit too is that, as I just take a look at the ages of the people who are kind of on this panel, you know, for an example, we come from different backgrounds and different traditions and that sort of thing. So I'm kind of one of those baby boomer guys, you know, so I've got kind of those characteristics go with me. And then we've got the XYZ population sort of after that, that takes us to the day kids. And so in terms of how we talk about commitment, try to teach that and kind of operationalize that for different people, it's going to be different for each age group that we're dealing with here, you know? And so we can think back and kind of go, yeah, when I was a kid or I was playing high school athletics, we never had those kind of problems. And we had different kind of problems back in those days, you know? And again, in those days, what the coach said, that's what you did. You know, what parents said, that's what you did. But our culture has evolved away from that, you know, with these different generations of people here now. So I just finished up a great book. It's called Working or Managing Millennials, you know, for the Dummies. It's a really good book. It really kind of breaks up the different pieces of those age groups that we're dealing with and how you really have to talk to them, basically. So even though I've worked with kind of that full spectrum, I have to pay attention to which age group I'm really working with there in terms of a word like commitment, or how do we operationalize that for them? How do we teach them? How do we demonstrate that to that group of people? It's different for different age groups. And so I think as we're talking about being coaches or support staff for teams, we have to pay attention to the age groups of people that we're working with, because how we describe these things and how we work with these ideas is going to be a little bit different.
Yeah, and I can attest to that. And all these coaching things that, you know, I learn and we talk about in all these shows, I've been using these in the workplace for a long time. And even today, when this topic, you know, as interesting as I was just thinking about what we'd be getting into, I realized, oh, this just happened 15 minutes ago in the office, which was trying to connect with someone. And I've got 20 somethings, 30 somethings, 40 somethings, 50 somethings, born in the U.S., born abroad, men and women. It's not a huge group. We just are pretty much of a rainbow tribe. And in some cases, I'll say, well, and my job is the chief engineer is to not have the answers, but just to see, are they coming up with good ones, to challenge them? Because I really don't do much of the problem solving. I just challenge them to see if they've gone about it. And a response was, well, fine, if you want me to do it that way, I will. And where they were heading was nowhere anywhere near, but they thought they were being, you know, quote, a good teammate, because we are a team. We've got to get our projects done right. If they go well, we get another one. And they were looking to comply by I think unknowingly disengaging from the goal. So the commitment that I was looking for was, no, tell me why you're right, or tell me why I'm wrong. We're here together. We're here for each other. It's tough. And I think, Lance, you mentioned, and I'd kind of like you to respond to this, is, you know, I perceive this as something that we, you know, we're aiming for younger people, but you mentioned, well, they all grow up into adults that we work with. And I think that's, you mentioned that's a little bit behind what you do. It's not always for the next generation now. It's for the next generation when they're us.
You know, I think the impetus behind why I started down this particular career path was, I kind of fell into it that teaching kids to be competitive was good at amateur sport level, but teaching kids to be good teammates was more important. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to discount the importance of competitiveness. You know, if my daughter was in a car accident, was laying on the operating table, I would hope that that surgeon is a competitive person for her sake. Well, so we need competitiveness. But at the same time, I hope that surgeon has the skill set to be able to work with others, to consult, to take advice, to have a commitment to more than just himself. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's really just about adding another layer to this. I mean, in fact, now also playing off of what Jim said, Mike, I'd like you to bring you into it, because you're working with the 20 somethings that will soon, they can't all go pro. In fact, you know, as we've always talked about, very few do, but you're preparing them to be that competitive person that may be the one saving one of our kids' lives, you know, out there somewhere. So tell us a little bit, Mike, about what you're seeing with regards to athletes and commitment and compliance. Are we making it too confusing, or do they have to deal with that?
No, I think you've all raised phenomenal points. And first off, thank you for having me on the show tonight. Let me start off with, I would argue that our compliance department within athletics would hope that all of our athletes are compliant to NCAA rules, but I know we're not talking about that type of compliance. What we're seeing a lot of with our student athletes anymore is, I think, a sincere desire to be a part of a family, to be a part of a team. And so if they believe when they get on campus that blind compliance with team norms is how they're going to be a part of that family, then they're willing to be blindly compliant. And part of what I do and what our job is in that freshman class, we want to educate them on what it means to be a Scarlet Knight and to be a part of the Scarlet Knight family, what some of those morals are, how to be a good person when everyone is in the room and watching you, when you're on the field, and how to be a good person when you're the only person walking on the sidewalk. You pick up a piece of trash because you have pride in your campus. You don't take advantage of the sheet that's left behind in class when someone has a quiz the hour after you. You really are just a good person in and out. And so making sure that they feel that those types of characteristics are what make them part of the Scarlet Knight family. And if we can reinforce that every single time that we see it and every single time that we hear about it, and we can highlight that in our student athletes, we think that that's going to lead to a very positive culture here in the Scarlet Knight athletics community and our family.
I do want to have you also play off of something Jim said, because he works with no pun intended. I mean, this is not a truly elite group when he's dealing with, Navy SEALs. That is truly an elite group of adults that have been through so many challenges and knowing what commitments are. Do you think that, we all see the movies, we see what's in the news, we have our heroes. Can some of these young men and women can they be looking to some people like that and saying, yeah, you got to be tough like that. You got to be, my day used to be, okay, we're going commando, from the movie. It was, we're all in. Okay. There's nothing stopping us. Are there great role models like SEALs out there where maybe it's, slightly misapplied as to that blind faith that they can want to adopt?
Well, that's a complicated question, I think.
Very.
I would say that our student athletes, yes, they can strive to that type of that level of family and that level of commitment to their teammates. And I think that's what we want them to do. We just have to, in our job as the adults, as the administrators in the room, is to make sure that that culture is based off of the right code of conduct, the right moral standards, the right actions and behaviors. And then if they want to take that family, if they want to take our family, pardon the pun, to the next level and truly, truly become a family, then we would love that commitment and that level and that compliance to it. But I think the job for the adults in the room is to make sure that it's based off of the right moral standards and code of conduct, like I said before. The commitment that I see out of our student athletes is truly inspiring. I mean, the level of work, the level of care. I get to work with some of our student athletes on a daily basis. And man, when they come in from a shared experience, like a really, really, really hard strength and conditioning workout or a brutal sprint regimen that they're doing a week before they have a massive game, like, and they're all like high-fiving and coming into the training room afterwards, like that, you do start to see the family. And I think that part of that is definitely through shared hurt as well when it comes to some of the strength and conditioning routines. I don't know if I'm answering your question necessarily, but I think that they can achieve that level of compliance and family that you see at the Navy SEALs and aspire to that. We just have to guide them there. Because like you said, they're 18 to 22-year-olds. You still need a little guidance at that point.
Yeah, and Lance, I'm going to let you wrap up and maybe also give from the perspective of when I see your posts, I just think they're perfect for the 12 to 18-year-old because they generally don't have the great support of someone like Mike or Jim around with them. Yep. You know, they have people like, you know, good coaches and parents like you and I that are around as much as we can be, or coaches that are getting resource from someone like yourself, but it's not, it's, they don't have that, you know, 360 coverage on them. So, any advice for those that are dealing with, you know, the middle to high school level is trying to teach this really difficult lesson? It really, it's a lesson that is meant for adults, but we want to plant that seed early. And any tips on how to deliver that a little more easily to their kids?
Yeah. Before I answer that, let me go back to something that Mike said. There was a day that I did work in athletic compliance. And as a compliance officer, it's challenging. Coaches come to you and they want to do something. And the challenge is you want to say, no, you can't do that. No, you can't do that. And, you know, you become the bad guy very quickly. And I think that can happen with high school teams too. You know, there's the captain wants to do something or the younger freshmen want to do something. And you're always saying, no, you can't do that. And you become the bad guy. So, you know, I shifted my mindset as a compliance officer. Instead of always saying no, I decide that's not my job to determine right or wrong, yes or no. My job is to operate in the gray area, if you will. And my job is to say, all right, how can I help you figure out what it is you want to do without breaking the rules? How can we do what it is you want to do without breaking the rules? And that's the creativity I needed to have as a compliance officer. When you talk to younger 18 to, you know, I don't know what the demographic is, 18 to 22-year-olds, you know, I think you got to have that mindset. All right. What it is we really want to do. Instead of hazing, we want to get closer as a team. All right, so how can we get closer? Can we go out for pizza? Can we go bowling? Is there other things, alternatives, things like that we can do? So I think you really got to stick to the core objective. And I'd like to go back. One more thing that Jim said I was fascinated with, and I wonder if he could even follow up on it. You know, we talk about the values of the, you know, the different generations. And I always assumed, and maybe Jim, I'm wrong, but when you talk to an 18-year-old or a 25-year-old who's in the process of becoming a Navy SEAL now with their life experience, and you go back to a 60 or 70-year-old man who was a former Navy SEAL, I always assumed, and I suspect, that the way they see commitment is not much different. Some of those core values are the same. Maybe they're labeled differently. Viewed slightly different, but I bet that core principle is the same. Would you say that's accurate?
Yeah, that hasn't changed much, you know, over the years, you know, that's for sure. I mean, they've created a formula, you know, for what they produce there for these young guys who actually come out of there, you know, as a SEAL. So they know it works. They kind of have cracked the code, you know, and they've done that now for, you know, quite a few years. And so they don't vary from that very much, you know, but one of the differences, let's say, between this particular group versus, let's say, a high school athletic team is attrition is permitted there, you know, with this particular group. Whereas in many high school sports, attrition isn't something that is built in. I mean, I work with a high school soccer team, you know, right now, and they have, you know, 100 kids that turned out for soccer today. Every one of them are going to be on the team. Yeah. You know, they'll be on the team, either the first team, second team, or reserve team, or something like that. So anybody who turns out is going to play. I mean, that's kind of the way that school operates. So we're dealing with a different kind of scenario when there's no, you know, when there's no attrition sort of allowed, you know, basically unless people simply just don't show up anymore, versus this special operations group where there will be attrition, you know, for a variety of reasons. But you're right. The values have not changed, you know, in spite of how the social system has changed, our culture has changed. It's something they're challenged with dealing with as well, as they get these different generations of people coming in. But literally how they communicate with people, it's been the same now since they started back in the 60s. You know, they use that. We don't have that luxury in high school and professional sports and that sort of thing. You know, yeah. we don't have that anymore. You know, there. So it's hard to compare those two groups of people, you know, because there's so many variables that play into one that don't play into the other.
I think that was a good thing to ask, because what that immediately took me to is where, when I work with younger coaches at the high school level, they also will coach club level. So we're at our local public high school, good talent, but we don't recruit, not even, you know, the way that some can, like, hey, you're pretty good. Is your apartment lease up? Maybe you'd like to get one on this side of the road and play for us next year. Our AD won't even do that. He's like, if you're here, you're here. But then, so I talk to other coaches, they'll coach club, which is, it's not a recruiting, but it's got that attrition level Jim was talking about, that everyone seeks the environment that's about right for them, so it, you can get on a page quicker. And I think where I saw you going before, Lance, was what's your why? And every kid, so like, why are you asking me my why? You know, they haven't even been told that's a legitimate question to ask yourself. So you have that range. So I think that to kind of dovetail it all together, when people are listening to all these different perspectives here, you know, it ranges from the group of this is what I get and I couldn't get rid of them and pare it down if I wanted to. Okay. Not the coaches want to, when you say, okay, well, you know, I'm not cutting, you know, I'm going to work with every kid that shows up. Very different from some of the tactics that others can take when it is a self-solving situation, that you do end up with those that say, oh yeah, we get that. That's why I'm still here. And the rest have gone elsewhere. And that's the service that we do. Those of us that are in the, okay, everybody who walks through the door, and like the group you talked about, Jim, that's a tough job where you've got that huge, huge breadth of perspective on what a commitment is. So Lance, any final words you want to throw in here before we wrap this one up?
Dave, I would sum the issue up like this. You know, there's some expressions in society that just go by the wayside, as they should, you know, and that's the nature of progress. We don't need quality bullwhip makers anymore, as the business axiom goes. Well, you know, the response, because I said so, is probably one of those expressions that's gone by the wayside. And maybe it should. You think there's a lot of, you know, bad elements we hear about in the news today of waywardness, because I said so, you know, probably time that maybe that should go. And that's a coaching thing and a student athlete thing. Now, the flip side of that, you know, coaches have a hard time accepting a student asking, well, why? And coaches need to get with times that, well, you have to have an explanation. And student athletes, you need to have an answer why too. And your why needs to be, because I am committed to doing what's best for our team. That's my summation.
I think it's perfect. Right. If you're going to ask why, you better know your why. So thanks a lot, everybody. Listeners, please do check out the show for links to all the guests, and we will have more of these great discussions. Thanks again, everyone.
Thank you. The years start coming and they don't stop coming. Back to the rules and I'll hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart but your head gets dumb. So much to do, so much to see. So what's wrong with taking the back streets? You'll never know if you don't go. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on,